Welcome back to Cornerstone tonight. So glad to see you again. Please stand together. We'll sing Count Your Blessings, song number 563. Good song for Thanksgiving time. Think about all the ways that God has blessed you tonight. All four verses, song 563.
When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does the cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. God has done.
On the third,
when you look at others with their lands and gold, think that God has promised you his wealth untold. Your many blessings money cannot buy, your reward in heaven or your home on high. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done.
On the last,
so amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend, help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Many blessings, see what God hath done.
Thank you. Please remain standing for a word of prayer.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this evening, a time to come together, Lord, and learn more about you and your, through your word, Father. I just pray that you bless us this evening, Lord, as the pastor reminds us of our responsibilities, Lord, to the world outside these doors, and bringing the lost in and seeing souls saved, Father. That's what we should be doing. And Father, just pray that you bless us as we learn about it and bless us as we go out and bring them in, Lord. And Father, we just pray that you'll just bless everything that the preaching and the singing and everything that goes on tonight to glorify your name. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, we'll be in song number 561, We Gather Together. The song makes me hungry thinking about Thanksgiving time. On that first verse, talks about cease from distressing. Always makes me think of turkey and dressing. I don't know why. All right, here we go.
We gather together to ask the Lord's blessing. He chastens and hastens his will to make known. The wicked oppressing now cease from distressing. Sing praises to his name. He forgets not his own.
Don't look at me like that. You thought of turkey and dressing too.
Beside us to guide us, our God with us joining, ordaining, maintaining his kingdom divine. So from the beginning, the fight we are winning. Thou, Lord, wast at our side. All glory be thine.
Turn around. and shake hands. Please join us on that third verse. We all do extol thee, thou loiter triumphant, and pray that thou still our defender will be. Thy congregation escape tribulation, thy name be ever praised. O Lord, make us free. Be seated, please.
All right. How many of you are hungry for dressing now? Yeah. Thank you, Brother Tar. There's another verse that made me think of something. It says, so from the beginning, the fight we were winning, fighting for the last dinner roll at the table, you know, fighting for the last casserole at the table. So yeah, amen. Well, so good to see you here tonight, and we're looking forward to being together in God's Word later. But it was wonderful seeing Amy Peck join the church and seeing everybody that was here this morning. And pray for all those that are traveling for the Thanksgiving holiday. How many of you are traveling out of state Thanksgiving holiday? Holiday, okay, great. Where are you going, Mrs. Fitzsimmons, where are you going? Illinois, okay. Who else is traveling out of state? Ah, yeah, the Lampers are here with us, okay. And anybody else traveling out of city? Hey, forgive him. And by the way, he's wearing Ohio State colors tonight, okay? Yeah, forgive him for that as well. Who said O-H? Who was that? Oh, okay, all right. Any Michigan fans here? Michigan fans? Okay, good. You know what they say about a house divided against itself cannot stand. So we'll move on past the sports, okay? But the sound ministry needs a volunteer for the Christmas cantata. And so if you're interested at all in working with Brother Sean with the sound equipment for the cantata that's coming up December 11th, please see Brother Sean for more information about that. Also, there's a marriage retreat sign-up sheet in the lobby. Please sign up if you're interested in going. Dr. Scott Hester is going to be our speaker. And so we're looking forward to 2 days being in the beautiful Country Lake Retreat Center and then spending time together as couples and listening to, I believe, a successful marriage tell us how to have a deeper relationship with one another. It's going to be great, so pray for that. Teen Snack, Sunday night after church. The Mortons, we're going to be hosting that. It's going to be November 27th. You're going to come to our house, and we're going to look forward to having a good time with that. Don't forget about this Tuesday. This Tuesday, I've been saying this long enough. Let's see if you've been listening. What's going on Tuesday? Someone tell me. Good. Pie and praise. What time does it start? 7 p.m. What are you supposed to bring? Peanut butter pie. All right. Reese's, chocolate, anything but rhubarb. Okay. Well, you can bring it. I just won't eat it. You can help yourself with that. But what is it? He'll eat rhubarb. So you can bring rhubarb for Brother Tar. All right. But yeah, we'll have a great time together. Bring something to share as far as a testimony and then a scripture verse to go with it. And we'll just have a great time together as a church family. There will be no Wednesday midweek service, so ladies, enjoy the extra prep time for Thanksgiving. And then there is no school this week, and so there will be no school office this week open. Monday and Tuesday this week, the church office will be open. And so if you need to get hold of us after that, just call us directly or leave a message or email us, and we'll get back to you as soon as we can. December 3rd, the Saturday Creation Museum church activity. Everyone's invited, and so if you're interested at all, please sign up in the lobby. We're going to be going to the Creation Museum, and we're going to be leaving at 3 o'clock, and then it closes at 8:30. So we're going to kind of get feedback from everyone going. If you want to leave sooner, we'll leave, but if you want to stay till close, We're going to be heading back. It's an hour and a half. So we'll leave at 3, and then if we decide to stay till close, we won't be back here till 10, okay? And then the live nativity, the Garden of Lights, the Animal Experience Playground is all free. In addition to that is whatever you choose to eat, however much you want to eat, depends on how much you eat, okay? And then the zip line is $20, and then the planetarium for the adults is $9, and $6 for the children, okay? And so we'll have a great time with that. Please sign up in the lobby. And we do have church transportation available if we have enough, okay? So please sign up in the lobby. If you need any other questions, just ask my wife or Miss Christine, and then they'll get you some more details. Here's some updates for you. The Weldy's grandson, Benjamin, had successful ear surgery, so praise the Lord for that. Did get a lady named Angelique. And Angelique, this is a woman that Amy Peck knows. She's a single mom that lost her only child, who was 16 years old, in a driving accident. So pray for a young mother named Angelique. And I'm sure that they would appreciate your prayers. Here's an update on Tammy Lloyd. Praise the Lord that she's home. She's recovering from her stroke and that she's doing well. She just needs lots and lots of rest. So thank you for praying. There is an update, too, on Shirley Williams. As of Friday, when we visited her, she was in room 1772, and they're not doing anything for her. It's kind of a waiting game at this point. They did give her days, but the family did tell us that they're going to be moving her to an end-of-life floor in the hospital, because currently she's on the surgical floor, so they're going to move her to an end-of-life floor. And so on the board, the nursing board, it just says comfort. So all they're trying to do is make her comfortable at this time. So please keep the family in your prayers. Mrs. Ledbetter still has pneumonia, so pray for her continued recovery. And it's good to see Jean Poizel here tonight. And she's doing better from her respiratory infection. And so did get two additions this morning I want to cover before we pray. The Wells family, so this is Miss Sherry Pointer. If is it Loretta? Is that your friend Loretta? Okay. Yes, ma'am. So please keep her in your prayers. It's her sister's mother-in-law who passed away. Yep. Yep. Yes, ma'am. Just pray for the family that's gathered by to hear the gospel and respond and get saved. She passed away from cancer, and it has a date here. Is that the day she passed? November 17th. Just keep the family in your prayers. Approaching the Thanksgiving season and losing a loved one, it's going to be tough for them. Just keep them in your prayers. And then here's one. Please forgive me for the name. I think it's, is it Gary? Jerry Shercliffe? Oh, okay. Sorry about that. Jerry, and they're in a coma from a brain aneurysm, and they're at Community North. She's at Community North, and this is Joni Pointers, is that?
It's Hallie.
Okay. Hallie and Callie's grandmother, that's in Community North in a coma from a brain aneurysm, so please keep them in your prayers as well. So many to pray for, and there's so many others as well. Just want to pray for these, and then we'll pray for the offering, and then we'll continue the service.
Dear Lord, we thank you that we can gather together this Sunday evening as a church congregation, that we can bring our petitions before you. We have the additions that are to the prayer list that we just heard from Pastor Morton. You know each and every situation there. We ask you to guide the doctor's hands and aid them to recovery. And whatever your will is in each of those situations, we ask you to provide comfort to the families that are grieving loved ones, especially be with the Williams family during this time of Thanksgiving. With Shirley in the hospital, we ask you to provide a special comfort to them as they go through this time. We ask your blessing now on the offering as we take it up here. We ask you to bless the work and the ministry here at Cornerstone, as well as supporting our missionaries around the world. We're thankful for the opportunities that you give us, that we can raise and provide for our families, and that we can give this small portion back to you, that we can use it to further your kingdom here on earth. be with Pastor Morton tonight. Open up our hearts to what you have for us this evening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God's grace. Let's stand together, please. We'll sing song number 201, Grace, Greater Than All Our Sin.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount, grace that will pardon and cleanse with. Tears are falling, hearts are breaking, how we need to hear from God. You've been promised, we've been waiting, welcome Holy Child. Welcome Holy Child.
Hope that you don't mind our main. How I wish we could have known. Long awaited, holy stranger, make yourself at home. Make yourself at home.
Bring your peace into our violence. Bid our hungry souls be filled. Word now breaking, heaven's silence. Welcome to our world.
Welcome to our world.
Fragile fingers sent to heal us. Tender brow prepared for thorn.
Tiny heart, his blood will save us. Unto us is born. Unto us is born.
So wrap our injured flesh around you. Breathe our air and walk our sod. Rob our sins and make us holy, perfect Son of God.
Perfect Son of God. Welcome to our
Amen. Thank you for that special. Man, it was just a great day in God's house this morning, and I'm looking forward to sharing with you what the Lord laid on my heart tonight. If you have your Bibles, turn to Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8, we're going to finish the chapter we didn't get to this morning with how to reach our community for Christ. Last time we were together, we talked about it starting with a right relationship with God ourselves. We can't hope to reach somebody with the gospel of Christ if we don't even know the Christ of the gospel ourselves. Starts with us having a personal walk and relationship with Him in salvation and our daily walks. Having our relationship right with one another. That's awkward, isn't it? Inviting someone to the church that you're at odds with. So having a right relationship is where it starts. But then number two, we talked about this morning, evangelizing the lost. Evangelizing the lost. And the last point that we talked about this morning was knowing how. Knowing how to tell someone else about Jesus Christ. And so we're going to give you some practical things to consider with how to tell someone how to be saved and share in the gospel with them. Before we get into this, this is going to tell me a lot about you as my church family. Raise your hand if you've already put up Christmas lights. You've already put up Christmas lights. How many of you already put up Christmas lights? Okay. How many of you think that we shouldn't even worry about Christmas until you're through with Thanksgiving? Raise your hand. Okay, yeah, I'm with you. And on our street driving home, I'm like, are those Christmas lights already? Don't they know it's like an unwritten rule? You can't do that till after Thanksgiving. But anyways, I'm just throwing that out there. That's extra biblical. That's just my opinion. You should at least wait until you fully celebrate Thanksgiving before you think about Christmas. And listen, I love Christmas music, especially when it talks about the Lord and Savior, but don't start playing Christmas music until December 1st, okay? All right, that's extra. I'm giving you time to find Acts chapter 8. Have you found it yet? Okay, good. Acts chapter 8, look at it with me in verse number 34. The Bible says this in verse number 34. It says, "And the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, of whom speaketh the prophet this, of himself or of some other man? Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their way, they came into a certain water, and the eunuch said, "See, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized?" And Philip said, "If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest." And he answered and said, "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God." And he commanded the chariot to stand still, and they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized them. And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. But Philip was found at Azotus, and passing through, he preached in all the cities till he came to Caesarea. And we're going to look at how to evangelize, how to witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to point this out here that in summary of what we talked about this morning, Philip was already busy serving the Lord, wasn't he? He was already busy telling people about the Lord and doing what he was supposed to. I want to make this application. Even though you may have done those things in the past, God still wants you to do those things now. It's not something you put in your time doing, and then you say, "I've done what I'm supposed to, and now I can just not do it anymore." Friend, you and I are called to be a witness for Jesus Christ until Jesus Christ returns or we pass away. And I want to challenge you with that application right out of the gate. Also, he was called by the Spirit of the Lord and led where? Do you remember? To the desert, specifically where? It starts with a G. Gaza, right? Gaza. So he's there. We talked about when God says go, you go. You don't make sense of it. You don't reason it. You just be obedient and go. And for the kids, you just saw the kids. The word's Philip, by the way. All right? So write down the word Philip and turn that into my wife, okay? All right. So Philip, we'll start. That's the first one. Okay, that was the first one. So Philip was led by the Lord to the middle of the desert, Gaza. He gets there. He doesn't twiddle his thumbs and start pouting. "I had a life back in the city, and now I'm in the desert." No, he looks around and sees why the Lord led him here, and there it was. Who did he see? The eunuch, the Ethiopian eunuch. And the Spirit then, at that point, led him, prompted him to draw near to the Ethiopian eunuch, and he does. He does, and he comes across this eunuch who had just went where to worship the Lord? Jerusalem. He went to Jerusalem to worship the Lord. And we'll see here in a moment how far he traveled, but he went there. He left this place of worship, and all he had was questions. He questioned, and after a religious ceremony, he had a bunch of questions that he was reading. What portion of Scripture? Isaiah. He was reading the book of Isaiah in verse 28, the prophet, and he had questions. And then Philip comes to him, and he says, "Do you understand what you're reading?" And he says, "How can I except some man guide me?" And I made the point to let you know what a witness for Jesus Christ is. The definition is this: guiding someone through the Scriptures and how they be saved. Guiding them through the Scriptures and showing them what the Bible says about being saved. And that's what our job is. Our job is just opening our mouth, opening our hearts to have the same heart that God has for lost souls, open our ears to receive teaching and instruction of how to be a witness, and then opening our mouth and letting the Holy Spirit of God speak through us and use us. And we're supposed to guide people. And this brings us up to where we're going to be tonight. Philip was a good Christian, wasn't he? He was a good Christian. Good Christian man. He was a good one. And I want you to notice the method that he used. What method did he use in reaching the Ethiopian eunuch? Was it lifestyle evangelism? Did he just act right in the desert right in front of the Ethiopian eunuch? No. Was it just loving on him? Did he go over there and just start loving on him, give him a big bear hug and say, "I love you, man. Love you, bro"? No, it wasn't. What method did he use? He took the what? The Word of God, the Scriptures, and began with that Scripture and preached unto him Christ. And I want to make the application: the gospel hasn't changed since that day in the desert. That day in the desert, the same gospel that Philip is preaching to the eunuch is the same gospel that I'm going to show us tonight how to present to the lost today. Because the truth doesn't change, we know that. The gospel, which is the truth, doesn't change. It's the same, and it's the same powerful gospel that Philip preached to that eunuch and that we're going to preach to lost souls today and now. Notice in verse number 37, if you would. He's obviously messed up in his theology. Because they get to a certain water there, and he pauses the chariot, stops the chariot, and says, look, there's water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? So apparently in his study and in his search for truth and religion, he obviously understood the importance of baptism. But he asked him, what doth hinder me to be baptized? Like, being dunked and baptized is the greatest need in his life at that moment. And Philip says, listen, notice what he says in verse number 37. And Philip said, if thou what? Believest. If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Now turn to Romans chapter 10, if you would. Romans chapter 10. This is all introduction. Stay with me, okay? Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10. I want you to see what this kind of ties in together with this. Romans Road, it's a part on the Romans Road. It sounds a whole lot to me like what Philip led the Ethiopian eunuch through. Chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, it says this. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth thee, what's the next two words? Lord Jesus. And shalt what? Believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be what? Saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Correct me if I'm wrong, church, but that sounds a whole lot to me like what the Philip led the Ethiopian eunuch through. He didn't say join Cornerstone Baptist Church. Not that it was around back then. He didn't say join my church. He didn't say work so your good outweighs your bad. He doesn't say get baptized, confess to me all of your sins. He said one thing, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Believest and thou mayest. So the method that Philip used even thousands of years ago was the same we use today. Some sinner that were to say, what do I need to do to be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. It's the same. But I want you to make some application here about this Ethiopian eunuch real quick. This Ethiopian eunuch, in my estimation, represents a lot of the lost people in our community around us. This Ethiopian eunuch represents many of the people that are lost in our community. How so? Well, there's a lot of people that are lost outside of these walls who are like this eunuch, who were religious but lost. Religious, but lost. I mean, this Ethiopian eunuch was going through the religious motions. He understood the importance and value of worship. And he was willing to leave Ethiopia and travel all the way to Jerusalem to worship God in the temple, in the synagogue. He was religious, wasn't he? But he was a religious lost man, wasn't he? He sure was. There are a lot of religious people outside these walls that are religious and they go through the religious motions, but they're lost as a goose in a hailstorm. Look what it says in verse number 27. And he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, an eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure and had come to Jerusalem, not to see the market, not to see the city, but for to worship. He traveled 2,605 miles to worship in Jerusalem, depending on where he was about that. Either by foot, camel, or donkey, he traveled 2,605 miles from Ethiopia to worship. I would say he was pretty religious to do that, but he was lost. He was pretty zealous about what he believed. Have you come across someone who was pretty zealous and adamant about what they believed that was wrong, but they were adamant that that was right, and that they were zealous about what they thought was right and what they believed? They were very zealous about it. So was this man who traveled the great distance. I'm sure it was a very costly trip to make to secure the service of a guide or the service of donkeys or camels or whatever mode of transportation that he used. Who would do that? Who would travel that long and spend that much money? Someone who is religious but lost and zealous about what they believed but lost. Do you think there's zealous people outside these walls about believing what they believe? You better believe it. Drive on German Church Road and you'll see a Hindu temple. It's massive. Hindu temple right here in the country of Lawrence, right there down the road. Hindu temple. I actually spoke with somebody who knew about the Hindu temple. They say people travel across the world in the states, United States of America, to come and worship in that temple. It's pretty zealous, isn't it? Pretty zealous to travel halfway around the world to worship in that temple. But will we agree they're lost? For sure. We think about the Mormons who are willing to do what they're called to do in their religion, taking a 2-year mission trip. And they believe that's part of working their way and earning through merit-based system of heaven. It's pretty zealous about what they believe, isn't it? People who travel hours to attend Mass, pretty zealous about what they believe, but all of them are lost. A lot of similarities between the lost today and this Ethiopian eunuch, for sure. This one is pretty sobering to think about. A lot of lost people out there, like the Ethiopian eunuch, who have God's word but are lost. Have God's word but are lost. Look at it in verse number 30. And Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah's and said, understandeth what thou readest. And he said, how can I except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him. He had a portion of the word of God. He was zealous and religious about reading the word of God, and he still was lost. Think with me, how many people have a copy of God's word that they read it and they go through it and they still miss the simple gospel message and still are lost today? It's amazing to think about. The Bible says this in 1 John 5:13, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may, what's the next word? Know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. That verse is in a lot of people's Bible, and people that still read the Bible still think and still make statements like this. If you knock on someone's door or speak to them about the gospel, you are going to hear them say this. Well, when you ask them, do you know for sure that if you were to die right now, are you sure that you'd go to heaven? Well, I don't know. Do you have a Bible? Well, yeah, I read it all the time. How can you read the Bible all the time and not know that that's something in here that you can know? And a lot of people don't know that. Some people say, I don't think it's for us to know. I don't think it's for anybody to know. We just do the best we can, and one day when we get to heaven, we'll find out. Friend, the reason we have the Word of God in English that we can read and understand, a big reason for that is that you may know that you have eternal life. God thought it important enough through inspiration to give you in writing His mind on the matter, and He wants you to understand that you can know that you're saved. And listen, He wants everybody in this community to know that same thing too. He wants them to know that. A lot of people have God's word, but still aren't saved. Pastor, how can that be? I mean, how can somebody read 1 John 5:13 and not get something else besides the fact that you can know for sure you're saved? Well, because 1 Corinthians 2:14 is in your Bible. 1 Corinthians 2:14 says this, but the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he, what's the next two words? Know them. Neither can he know them, because they are what? Spiritually discerned. Would you agree with me tonight that this is a spiritual book? It's got God's Spirit on it. When the Bible said, when we hear the preaching about the inspiration of the Bible, it doesn't mean that God took man's writing and breathed his breath on it. No, friend. Every word of God was given, and it has His Spirit dripping on every page. It's a spiritually discerned book. The reason that some people can have God's word and not get what it's trying to say is because they're not saved and born again. How can they understand? It's going to take you and I as believers who have the indwelling Spirit of God in our lives to guide them to the place where they can read and understand what it means. It's a big responsibility that we have. So here's some principles from Philip that show us how to evangelize the lost. Here's some principles from Philip that show us how to evangelize the lost. And this is going to be pretty simple and basic. I told you that this morning to be prepared for that, okay? Look at it with me in verse 35. Verse 35 says, "Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same," what's the next word? Scripture. That's where it all starts, friend. It all starts with you and I knowing the scriptures to show them. Let's be frank. Anything else apart from scripture when it comes to our giving the gospel to somebody is pretty much irrelevant, right? We can give them our testimonies, and that's important, but nothing trumps sharing with them scripture. Because that's where the power of God comes from. It's the power of God and the Word of God. That's where the power comes from. And we need to start with knowing the Scriptures to show them. And we're going to show you that in a moment here, okay? Starts with the Scriptures. That's where Philip started, and that's where it starts with you and I as well. He relied on the source of power, the Scripture, to lead that man to Christ. He wasn't relying on his ability. He wasn't relying on his knowledge or his fluency of speech. He relied upon the Scripture, and that's where he began. Let me ask you two questions. Do you know enough Scripture to show someone from the Bible how to be saved? Don't answer that out loud, but do you know that? Do you know enough Scripture to show someone from the Bible how to be saved? Philip obviously did. He picked up with his question. He was able to answer the Ethiopian eunuch's question, and then he then led right into what it required him to do to be saved, and that's believe. And he knew, in that moment, he knew how to answer that question and then take that question and incorporate it into leading into the gospel, and he did it. Let me ask you another question. Do you know some plan, some approach, some method of sharing the gospel? And when I'm talking about the plan of salvation, there's not one right way and everything else is wrong. It's the Word of God. You could take someone from the book of Psalms, the book of Isaiah chapter 53, the book of John, the book of Acts, the book of Romans, and show someone how to be saved. So as a disclaimer, the way that I'm going to show you is not the only approach, not the only plan. But when we talk about the plan of salvation, all that means is an organized collection of verses that clearly shows someone what salvation is all about. That's what I'm talking about. A plan of salvation is just an organized collection of verses that just shows someone what the Bible says about that topic. Do you know a plan? Do you know some way of doing that? We're going to get to that in a moment. The second thing he did was this. Not only did he begin with Scripture, but number two, he preached Jesus. I made mention of this morning, but he preached Jesus. Look at it in verse number 35. Then Philip opened his mouth and began at that same Scripture and preached unto him, what? Jesus. Jesus. Someone said this, if you run out of things to preach about, just preach on Jesus and you'll never run out of something to preach about. Preach about Jesus' goodness, his love. Preach about Jesus. And if you're ever at someone's door or in a conversation with someone and you blank out, that's still good advice for you and I as well. As witnesses, just brag about, talk about, and praise Jesus in front of them. Talk about Jesus, what Jesus has done in your life. Okay, so what? Let's put away the plan. Let's put away the verses and memorize the Scripture. You should be able to tell someone what Jesus has done in your life and my life. Right? That's our testimony. What Jesus has done in our life. Don't lust on your past. But friend, if you knew what God saved me from, man, you would want it to. Man, you want it to. You don't know me, sir. You don't know me, ma'am. But I was lost on my way to hell. God loved me so much that he sent Jesus to die for me. And I accepted him by faith. I'm not perfect, but I praise God I'm not what I used to be. And we should be able to at least share with somebody what Jesus has done in our lives. And that's what Philip did. He preached Jesus. He didn't know everything there was to know about the Bible. He didn't know all the doctrines, didn't know all the things to share, but he preached what he knew, and he knew Jesus, and he preached him. Acts chapter 9, verse 20. And straightway, who is this talking about? Acts chapter 9. Does that ring a bell? Who's that talking about? Paul, right? The Apostle Paul. And straightway, he preached what? Christ in the synagogues. Yes, I understand Paul was raised up as a religious Jew, and he knew the Torah, and he knew all that, okay? But he just recently entered into a personal relationship with Jesus. He didn't know everything outside of what he was taught as a Pharisee about Christ, But you know what he did? He just got busy sharing what he knew about Christ in that moment. Jesus changed me. Boy, I tell you what, I was on my way to Damascus. I was actually trying to persecute the church. And Jesus appeared before me, and I asked him, Lord, what will thou have me to do? And he changed my life, and he wants to change your life too. Paul just got busy preaching what he knew about Christ to anyone and everyone that would listen. And there's some wisdom in us doing the same thing as well. And I want to share with you some verses tonight. And I want you to get a pen out, some type of way to mark these verses. And once again, there is no trademark or copyright on this. If you have a way that you are more familiar with or you know better, please do it, okay? But if you're trying to learn how to take God's word and share it with someone else and lead them through them, guide them through it, and lead them to salvation, here's a good approach to it, okay? I'm going to give you these verses, how I show someone how to be saved, and you can mark it. I'd encourage you. I have a New Testament in my pocket. It's a really thin New Testament. I keep it in my back pocket, and I put tabs in there. The verses I'm going to share with you are in order. So get tabs and put number one, number two, number three, number four, number five, all the way through. Why do we do that? Because any human is a human being, and you have a short window of attention span before the oven goes off, before the phone stops ringing, before the kid runs out the house, or you know they're done finishing pumping up their gas. So every second counts. Okay, every second counts before that window of attention span closes, or they're done, or they drive away, or they get distracted. So every second counts, and I don't want me stumbling through trying to flip and find passages be the thing that I miss my window of opportunity with them. So if you mark them, put tabs, and a way to quickly turn to each verse, it eliminates that dead time in between, and it lets you stay on top of it and keep going with the plan as you go through it, okay? So here's the first verse. This is the question that I lead with, and once again, this is just how I do it. I'm sharing it with you. Do with it what you want. But I ask them this question. And there is benefit in showing them that you're a human being. I don't just walk up to someone and say, if you died right now, do you know Christ? I don't do that. I try to lead in with questions and trying to talk to them. And because anytime you approach someone that you don't know and they don't know you, there's going to be an element of defensiveness, okay? They're going to be defensive. So anything that you and I could do to lower down their guard and open up to us is going to be beneficial. So I always try to look for something to start the conversation with, okay? And I've already told you, I'm not naturally an outgoing person, so I have to study at it and work at it. If I see him, where's Brother Terry at? If I see him wearing an Ohio State t-shirt, I don't know why you would, but in case they did, okay? I don't know a lot about Ohio State. I know that they have a sports team. There he is right there, okay? I go up and say, hey, how's Ohio State doing this year? And they'll start to say, yeah, they're number one, and they're the best team, yeah. And you have to stomach some of that, okay, to get through it, okay? But we ask the question, and they tell us about Ohio State, and I tell them I'm a Tar Heel fan, and I hear the flack that comes with being a Tar Heel fan, and I have to stomach that too, okay? You got to have thick skin as a soul winner, okay? So after we get through that, I go and ask them the question. Hey, do you mind if I ask you a question? If you were to die right now, would you know for sure that you're saved? Would you know 100% sure that you would go to heaven? And depending on their answer, they may say, well, no, I don't think so. Or yes, yeah, I know. Never take for granted that because they answer yes, that they are in fact going to heaven. Always investigate. If they say yes, say, I'm not trying to be rude or nosy, but why are you confident that you're going to heaven? Can you share with me how you know that you're going to heaven? Well, I try to be a good person. Is that what gets anybody to heaven? No. Well, I try to have my good outweigh my bad. I'm trying to turn a new leaf over. I'm trying to be good. I'm trying to do better. I'm trying to be a good citizen. I give money to charity. I mean, I go to church. I go to such Baptist church. None of that stuff is what it takes to be saved on your way to heaven. So always ask them, why are you sure? Why are you confident that you're on your way to heaven? If it's anything else, but we know what the Bible says, I've accepted Christ my Savior. They may not know the lingo, But I know Jesus Christ is my Savior. I've placed my faith in Jesus, or I've trusted Christ as my Savior. Whatever, that's what you're kind of looking for, okay? But if they say, no, I don't think anybody can know, or I don't know, always lead with this verse, or I lead with this verse. Go to 1 John 5:13. 1 John chapter 5:13, it answers the question you just asked them. What was the question you just asked them, church? Do you know for sure? And their answer let you know that they obviously don't know for sure. If they say, well, I don't think anybody can know for sure, this verse will eliminate all those doubts and questions. So 1 John chapter 5:13 is the first place that I take them, because I want them to see from Scripture that God wants them to know. He wants them to have the confidence of knowing that you're saved. You don't have to wander through life hoping so. You don't have to go to bed at night wondering if, in fact, you are saved. God wants you to have the confidence that accompanies knowing Him as your Savior. And so 1 John 5:13 is the first place that I take them. And the Bible says this: these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may, and I circle the word know, and I show them my Bible, and I ask them, can you tell me what that word is? Because I want them to see it. Well, no, that you may know. Does it say that you may hope so? Well, no. Does it say that you have to wonder from day to day? No, it says that you may know. You may know. That ye, I circle the word have. Some people think that they have to be good and work their whole entire life, and one day at the pearly gates, at that point, they'll know if they've made it or if they haven't. No, friend, the Bible says it was written that you may know that ye have. Currently, right now, if you believe on Christ, you have eternal life and the assurance of knowing that you're saved on your way to heaven. And so I tell them that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. I tell them that you can know for sure that you're saved. And then I take him to Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3 is the next verse. If you would turn there and make mark of that, Romans chapter 3, verse number 10. The Bible says this. It says, as it is what? Written. We just talked about in 1 John 5:13, these things were what? Were written. God has things in writing that he wants you desperately to read and understand. And this is no different. It says, as it is written, there is, and I pause and I say, tell me what that word is. What's the next word, church? None. Zero. None. There is none righteous, no, not one. And don't take for granted that people understand what words mean. So I define everything. Sir, ma'am, let's just say it's a sir. Sir, do you understand what that big word is, the big word righteous? Do you know what the word righteous means? Not really. That word means perfect. It's a simple word that means perfect. And I ask them, are you perfect? I've never had someone tell me they're perfect. In all these years, they're at least have that much understanding to not be that prideful in front of a preacher and say they think they're perfect, okay? So no one's ever told me, yeah, I'm perfect. No, I'm not perfect. And I say there's none. You've answered right, because the Bible says there's none perfect. Nobody alive today is perfect without sin. The Bible says that, myself included. And then I take them to Romans chapter 3, verse 23. The Bible says, for, what's the next word? All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And I ask them, what does the word all mean? Well, it means everybody. I said, sir, would all include you? Well, yeah, it sure does. For all have, what's that word say? Sinned. Do you know what sin means? Well, it's, you know, they may give you some specifics, and if it's too graphic, please pause and stop them, okay? But you can say, yeah, okay, yeah, those examples are right. It can be, you can name something like sinning, lying, telling a lie, stealing, those are sins. But specifically, the Bible says what sin is in 1 John 3:4. If you want to give them a biblical definition of sin, you could take them to 1 John 3:4. The Bible says this: whosoever committeth sin, what's the next part? Transgresseth also the law. For sin is the what? Transgression of the law. Sin literally means breaking God's law. I ask them, do you know what sin is? And they tell me some examples, and I say, that those are right. But it's the Bible says it's breaking God's law. According to Scripture, you just told me that you're included in the word all. And the Bible says, for all have sinned and broken God's law. Do you know what that makes you, sir? Do you know what that makes me? A lawbreaker. We're a lawbreaker. Then I take him to Romans chapter 6, verse 23. Romans chapter 6, verse 23, the Bible says this, for the wages of sin is what? Is death. According to the Bible, we as sinners who have broken a law, broken God's law, the wage. Do you know what a wage is, sir? Do you know what a wage is? Someone tell me what a wage is tonight. Something you earned, a payment, and I give them the example of a work week. You work Monday through Friday, you put in your 40 hours, and come Friday, you're expecting your what? Your wage, something you've worked for and you deserve as a payment. As a sinner, someone who's broken God's law, do you know what we deserve, sir, according to Scripture? Well, death. That's right, death. But it's not talking about physical death, because everybody dies. Whether you're saved or lost, everyone dies, don't we? We sure do. So there's something else being mentioned here, and I take them to Revelation 21:8. Revelation 21:8. The Bible says this, but the fearful, those that are afraid, and unbelieving, those that don't believe, and the abominable, think about the most awful thing you could ever think about and commit. I mean, the most grievous sin you can commit. It's despicable. And murderers, taking someone's life, and whoremongers, those that do sexual sins with their bodies, and sorcerers and idolaters, black magic, wizardry, and sorcery. And I pause them and I say this, you may be thinking right now, what does this verse have to do with me? I've never murdered anybody. And I ask them, I say, would we agree that someone who murders someone deserves a punishment? And everyone, of course, will say yes. I mean, it's a no-brainer, right? We all would associate the grievous sin of murder as deserving of a punishment. And I make it a point to ask them that. Would you agree that taking someone's life is wrong and deserves punishment? Well, sure does. Notice what the Bible says next. It says, and all what? Liars. And all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the what? Second death. So, sir, according to Scripture, murder is deserving of hell, but also a lie is a sin that's broken God's law and is deserving of hell. You may disagree with that, but that's what God says, and God looks at sin as sin. Lying is a sin, and murder is a sin, and it's deserving of hell. So, sir, would you agree that when, what does the word say there? It says, and what? All. You already said that, and all have sinned. Would all include you as well? Well, yeah, it would. Have you ever told a lie before, whether big or small? Have you told a lie before? Answer me, church. Have you told a lie before? Yeah, we all have. The Bible says, and all liars, okay? We all have told a lie before. Any time we've told nothing but 100% of the truth, 100% of the time, it's a lie, and we're guilty. And they say, well, I told a lie before. According to Scripture, we're deserving of the second death. The first death is physically being placed in the ground. The second death is your soul being separated from your body and spending forever apart from God in a place called hell, in the lake of fire. That's the bad news, but here's the good news. I didn't come here to discourage you. Here's the good news. Romans chapter 6, 23b, the next part. It says, for the wages of sin is death. Although you are, and I summarize it, although you are a sinner, a lawbreaker that deserves hell forever, God wants you to know this truth too. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through going to Cornerstone Baptist Church. Through having your good deeds outweigh your bad. you're gained that gift of eternal life by being baptized. What's the Bible say? And I have them read it. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, period. That's all there is. It's through. The only way that we have the chance to be saved is through the Lord Jesus Christ, period. End of statement. That's all it takes. And you might be wondering, I ask them, you might be wondering, why on earth would anybody do something as nice as giving the gift of eternal life to someone who's a lawbreaker? That's pretty simple. In Romans chapter 5:8, it says this, "But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." Sir, your sin did not catch Jesus from surprise. He wasn't nailed to the cross and then found out about your sin and that changed his mind. He knew that you were a sinner before he went to the cross, and he loved you enough to go there anyway. Isn't that amazing to think about? He was willing to become your sin on that cross and die for all of your sins, past, present, future. You might be thinking, okay, here's the catch. Here's where you're going to ask me to come to your church and be baptized and start tithing, and here's where the strings start getting attached, right? Nope. And I tell them the best thing about biblical Christianity, there is no strings attached. In Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, it says this, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth all of your sins to me. Is that what it say? Is that what it says? If thou shalt confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus. I ask him, sir, do you understand why you don't have to stand here and confess to me all of your sins? Number one, I'm a sinner just like you. I don't need to know your sins. I've got plenty enough to worry about on my own. Number two, Jesus Christ, the reason he didn't ask you to confess all your sins as a stipulation of being saved is because Jesus Christ has already died for those sins and paid for those sins. All he wants you to do in this very moment is from a position of faith and trust in him, confess him as your Lord and Savior. That's what he wants you to do. If thou wilt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou might be saved. Is that what it says? What does the Bible say? Thou shalt be saved. Thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. I say, sir, I'm a human being like you. I can't see your heart. God knows the sincerity of your heart. Do you believe what the Bible says? And I review, do you believe that you're a sinner? Well, yes, I do. Do you believe that as a lawbreaker in the eyes of God, you deserved the second death of hell forever? Yes, I do. Do you believe that God loved you so much that he sent Jesus Christ to die for your sins? Yes, I do. I make sure that they believe that. Do you believe that he was buried and rose again? Because that's the gospel as well. The death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Yeah, I do. I really do believe that. The Bible says this in Romans 10:13, that if thou shalt confess, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And whosoever means anybody. Anybody that will trust him and put their faith in him. We could even put your name in there. We're not adding to scripture. We're just trying to clarify the point. For if Dave shall call upon the name of the Lord, Dave shall be saved. Dave, wouldn't you like to call on Christ today and save you? It literally, the word call, it literally is like you taking your phone out and calling a friend and talking to them. From your heart to theirs. That's what God wants you to do right now in this very moment, is to call on him in faith and accept him as your Savior. And to illustrate the confessing part, believe and confess, I do this. I tell them, confessing with your mouth, you're confessing what you believe in your heart. I love my wife. I love her in my heart. I love her. I tell her I love her. I confess that I love her, how I feel about her in my heart. I make it known to her what's in my heart through confessing it with my mouth. And God in this very moment wants you to confess him as Lord and Savior and accept him as your Savior. And I tell them, look, at this point, they do not need us anywhere near to be saved. We aren't the one that has to officiate the transaction in order for it to be authentic. We have done everything that we are biblically responsible for by going and being obedient to do what God's told us to do. By opening up the scriptures and sharing them and guiding them through the scriptures, what God says they need to do to be saved. And you've brought them to a point in this process of making an application and to a point of decision. Do not pressure them. Do not manipulate them. Do not force them to say some prayer and put their name on a card. You leave the responsibility to them to decide what they do. And I told them right now, I told them at the end of this, I said, look, you don't need me here to be saved. All you need to do is from your heart, the best that you know how, ask Christ to save you, and he will. I say, you could say something like this, but it's not the words that save anybody. It's from your heart believing what the Bible says he did for you and asking him to save you. But if you need some type of guideline, people have never prayed before. They have no idea what prayer is. Give them some type of guideline. You could say something like, Jesus, dear Lord, I know that I'm a sinner. I know from the Bible that I deserve hell. I'm trusting you to save me. Please save me and change me and forgive me for my sins. Something simple like that. You could pray something like that. Would you like to pray now? If you don't, I'll happily go my way. And if they say yes, then I tell them, look, pray in your heart because it's not the words that save you. I'm just going to pray out loud, thanking the Lord for bringing me your way, thanking the Lord for having you have an open heart, and just honestly just praise the Lord while you pray in your heart. And I'll pray, and I'll wait till they're done. And I ask them, I said, did you pray in your heart and ask Jesus Christ to save you? Yeah, I did. Do you believe that Jesus Christ heard you and saved you? Yeah, I do. And then I begin to show them other verses that we'll talk about later. But in a nutshell, in about 5 minutes or less, you can show them enough scripture verses for them to understand what Jesus Christ did for them and for them to choose him as their Savior. Here's the question. Will you and I take the time necessary to learn this? Will you and I take the necessary steps of finding times to share some gospel with people, share the gospel with people? Will you and I do everything we can as the spiritual guide, the witness, the evangelist, to go out and do what we're supposed to be doing? Because we could have every program under the sun. We could have a fall festival every weekend of the year, but it won't do anything. It won't touch the tip of the iceberg of a church that has a heart for God, heart for souls, and will go out and busy themselves being personal witness for him throughout the week. Will we do that as a church? Will we have a heart for that? We'll go ahead and have an invitation, have the musician come forward, and just a simple, practical thing tonight, but hopefully it was a help to you. There's more to it that we'll discuss in the weeks to come, but basically in about 15 verses or less, 5 minutes or less, you can share with someone what Jesus Christ did for them. Share with them what the Bible says it takes to have a personal relationship with him. And in 5 minutes or less, Jesus Christ can change their life into a new creature and save their eternal soul in about 5 minutes or less. Will you and I have a heart that God has for souls? I want us, Brother Tard, you know that chorus, each one can reach one. We're going to sing it, and this is something the Lord laid on my heart, okay? Here's a chorus that goes like this. I want this to be a theme chorus for us. This year as a church, each one can reach one, okay? I want to sing it one time. We'll have us all sing it together. Let it really sink in, and then we'll have Brother Tar lead us in whatever song he chose. But it goes like this. Each one can reach one. As we follow after Christ, we all can lead one. We can lead one to the Savior, and together we can show the world that Jesus is the way if we each one reach one. It's so true. If we just have a heart for reaching one soul for Christ, man, before long we'll have this place filled. Before long we'll have a lot of people in our community saved and reached with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it starts with us just having a desire for one soul. God, just give me one soul. And watch what he does through that. Would you help me? Would you just try to sing that chorus one time? And we'll sing it randomly throughout the year. And then Brother Tar can just lead us in whatever song he has. But let's sing that chorus, each one can reach one, okay? Each one can reach one. As we follow after Christ, we all can lead one. We can lead one to the Savior. And together we can show the world that Jesus is the way if we each one reach one. Brother Tar, would you please stand to your feet? We'll have an invitation, and Brother Tar will lead us.
Search me, O God, and know my heart today.
Try me, O Savior, know my thoughts, I pray. See if there be some wicked way in me. Cleanse me from every sin and set me free. This will be the last verse, the last verse. If you know somebody in your family that's lost, Thanksgiving brings people together like no other holiday, really. We're going to be around our family and around the turkey and dressing, but use that opportunity this year to be a witness for Christ. Think about a way that the Lord can use Thanksgiving and bringing your family together this year to get the gospel, incorporate the gospel message in there. Go around the table and have people say what they're thankful for, and you be the one that thank Christ for your salvation. Use Thanksgiving as a way to reach all of our family and loved ones with the gospel. It will be the last verse, and we'll conclude the service tonight.
Oh, Holy Ghost, revival comes from thee. Send a revival, start the work in me. Thy word declares thou wilt supply our need. For blessings now, O Lord, I humbly plead.
Thank you, appreciate it. Thank you. All right, thank you so much for being here tonight. And Lord bless you and keep you safe as you go home. I want to remind you, this Tuesday is our Pie and Praise Night at 7. And looking forward to spending some time together as a church family. And then keep these folks in your prayers. The grandmother of Hallie and Callie with in a coma from the brain aneurysm. And then the Mrs. Pointer's friend's mother-in-law, or sister's mother-in-law, who passed away. Pray for that family and pray for the Williams family and so many others on our prayer list. So we'll go ahead and be dismissed in prayer. Pastor Haig, please dismiss us in prayer. And we're so glad to have the Lanfer family with us. They're our friends from Florida, and we're so happy to have them with us. They're going to be visiting with us. Go by, and they're Michigan fans, okay, right? Michigan fans, so don't hold that against them. Be friendly to them anyway, okay? Make them feel welcome, and God bless you tonight. After we dismiss, we'll see you again Tuesday.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this evening. Lord, just thank you for each and every one that came tonight to hear the Word of God, and we just thank you for these verses to help us. Lord, help us to just share this these verses with others as we go about our day and our and each and every person that we see. Let's remember what we're supposed to do, and handing them tracts and sharing the gospel with them. Help us, give us the courage to do that each and every step of the way. Lord, help the Holy Spirit to work in our through our hearts and our minds as we speak to these folks and invite them to church. And not only that, but Lord, that we'd lead them to the Lord wherever we may be. And Lord, it's all for the glory of you. And we just thank you for tonight. And Lord, thank you for the message tonight. Just be with it, each and every one. Keep your hand upon the families throughout the week, ones that are going through trials and just hard times. Lord, pray you give them peace. These different families that have lost loved ones. And Lord, pray for Mrs. Shirley Williams. Lord, just give her comfort at this time. And Lord, we just thank you for her and her just amazing attitude that she's always had. And Lord, we just thank you for her family. Just give them peace through this time as well. Lord, just pray that you be with the week, each and everyone traveling. Just give them safety on the roads, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Don't go anywhere. Sorry, don't go anywhere. We have an anniversary today. I don't want to leave anybody out. I know we've already ended the service, but raise your hand. We're going to vote, church vote, if we should sing happy anniversary to the Andersons. It's unanimous. It's unanimous. 100% of the vote, all right? So let's sing happy anniversary, sweeter as the years go by, okay? Sweeter as, should we make them come forward, come front, or just leave them there? Okay, we won't embarrass them too bad, okay? Let's just sing sweeter as the years go by in 29 years. Is that right? 29 years, and so praise the Lord for that. Let's give them a hand for that. That's awesome. That's great. And let's go ahead and sing sweeter as the years go by. Here we go. Sweeter as the years go by, sweeter as the moments fly, richer, fuller, deeper, Jesus' love is sweeter, sweeter as the years go by. Oh, amen. Praise the Lord for that. God bless you guys. Have a great night. Have a great night.